the need for a savior. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, or you will die." "You will not certainly die," said the serpent to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be just like him, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good and it was pleasing to the eye and it was also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and she ate it. She also gave some to her husband and he ate it. And then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. From the moment that Adam and Eve ate the fruit, mankind needed a savior. As God confronted them in the garden for their sin, Adam and Eve listened intently to the words of their Maker. They heard him curse the serpent. They heard God promise that through the descendants of Eve would come one who would crush the head of Satan. So Adam and Eve understood this as the initial promise of a savior. To them, this was a bit of good news. So when they were evicted from the garden, what do you think the first thing they did was? They immediately started a family, believing that one of their children would be the one to save them, the one to end sin, and the one to defeat the enemy. How heartbroken they must have been when the eldest of their two sons took the life of the other. Things didn't really seem to get any better. The Bible goes on to record at least six more generations appearing on the face of the earth. Child after child, birth after birth. Is this the one? Is that the one? Has he finally arrived? It wasn't until this succession of events that mankind began to realize that the Savior has still not come. The Bible tells us that it was at this time that people began to cry and call on the name of the Lord. And that calling, it echoed through the ages, through the flood, the bondage and the liberation of the Israelites in Egypt. Is he here yet? The desecration and the exile of Israel by foreign countries. Is he here yet? The days turned into weeks. The weeks turned into months. The months, years. The years, decades. And the decades into centuries. Just waiting. Where is he? Where is this so-called Messiah? Is he even real? When spirits were low and the frustration had reached its highest, and the earth was at its darkest moment, Jesus then decided to deploy himself into the earth in the form of a child. At that point, the wheels were set in motion, and the plan of redemption had begun. In this first set of songs, you will hear the triumphant declaration of the angels to the shepherds. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to all men. You will hear the outcry of mankind, dayspring of life that gives us hope. Please guide our way. Lead us to the way of peace. There will be moments in this service where we will read together and where we will sing together. So join us as we celebrate this Easter story.
Give life to those that live in darkness, shadow death. Would you guide us home? Lead us to the song, O Lamb of God, I invite you to sing with us, Your Only Son.
Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty side and to become the fall, and though
I'll invite you to stand as we read together this responsive reading. I will read, and the choir and congregation will respond. Early in the morning, all of the chief priests and elders of the people came to the decision to put Jesus to death. They bound him, they led him away, and they handed him over to Pilate, the governor.
"What shall I do then, for Jesus, who is called Christ?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him."
Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they laid him away to crucify him. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. Let's read this together. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Amen. You may be seated.
that tongue or pen can never tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son to wed his erring child. He reconciled and pardoned from his.
Behold the man upon the cross.
The rest. Many Christians gather to remember the Easter weekend on each day of significance, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. The most common times to gather are on Friday, as we remember the sacrifice given on that dreadful afternoon. Emphasis is also placed on the suffering that he endured and its meaning. This momentarily pulls us away from the subtle hypnosis of the everyday life we are accustomed to living, going to and fro our daily responsibilities without truly allowing ourselves or our lives to reflect the gratitude of the high price that was paid for our salvation. The other emphasis is placed on Sunday morning. For obvious reasons, it was a victorious moment in the story. But not much emphasis is placed on what happens on Saturday. You see, while on the surface to the human eye, Jesus, he rested in the tomb. But the scriptures give us a glimpse of what was taking place in the supernatural. In the book of Revelation, it paints the picture like this. Jesus says, "I am the living one. I was dead, and look, now I am alive forever and ever. Why? Because I now hold the keys of death, hell, and Hades." You see, by completing the sacrifice, Jesus went to hell, broke down the gates, and set us free. Because he has the authority. Imagine with me, if you will, going home after this service, only to find your home that your landlord or your mortgage lender has broken into your home, declaring that they are changing the locks and you are officially evicted. Because they have the authority, they can make that happen. In the same way, we no longer are sentenced to an eternity of bondage to sin. The Bible says that we are all born and shaped in iniquity. We cannot help but want to sin all the time. We've been doing it for years, and some of you are better at it than I am. But we are all set free. And the Bible says, "He that has been set free is free indeed." You see, there isn't much music in the Easter season that talks about the rest and what happened while he was in the tomb. This is why we are excited to minister this next song. It is translated to say that Christ laid in the bonds of death, trapped in its grip on our behalf. The entire cantata written by Bach has four verses, but we are singing verse 1. And I would like to share for you the translation of verse 3. It says it was a strange battle between life and death. Life claimed the victory as it devoured death, just as the scriptures promise. But how strange it was that one death conquered the other. Because of this, we can praise God, we can thank Him, and we can shout hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. In only a way that Johann Sebastian Bach can write, our hallelujahs literally mock the lost power of death. Christ lag in totis bonden. The enemy had made deliberate efforts to defeat Jesus, and though he knew the prophecy, though he knew the scriptures, there was nothing he could do to keep the body of Jesus inside of the grave. Death could not hold him. The grave could not contain him. The darkness could not cover him. He arose. He arose. With all power, omnipotence in his hands. Hallelujah. Jesus snatched the keys of death, hell, and the grave from the enemy. So I ask you, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Open. The song says, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Thank you, Jesus. Let's stand up and sing this song together. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
I'm not afraid to afternoon, church. In 2 Corinthians 9, 6 to 7, it says, "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who also sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purpose is in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. The Lord promises if we return his tithe and offering, he will open up the windows of heaven and give his blessings beyond our abilities to receive them. There are millions of faithful Christians who give their tithes and offerings to the Lord and are richly blessed. They are blessed because they trust God and is obedient to his word. Are you obedient and trusting that the Lord will provide for you? Let us remember that the Lord is faithful in all of his promises. If we obey his word and return to him what is his, the Lord in turn will richly bless us. Prove him and see that he will uphold his promises. He will bless you beyond ability to receive. May the deacons please come forward. For prayer. Our God and Father, thank you for providing for us, for sending the sunshine and rain, for providing food on our table. Help us to take hold of your promises and to trust you. Bless your tithe and offering, and bless those that gave and for those who are unable to give. In your name, amen. For our online givers, you can give at www.thetpchurch.org.
His offer a special prayer. This has been so special, so rich. Let's pray. Today, Lord, we have revisited the cross. We have tasted of the love of Jesus. We have been reminded and rebathed in the glory and meaning of his sacrifice. Kings and kingdoms may pass away, but there's nothing like the name of Jesus. And so we are saved, and we are grateful, and we are filled, and we are warmed, we're uplifted, we're set free by the name of Jesus. Thank you for this ministry today. Thank you that we were here. In Jesus' name. I said, in Jesus' name. I said, in Jesus' name. Amen. Give God glory again. Give God glory again. Wow. What about these singers? Come on. Huh? Now, all of the musicians got up and left, except Heskey and his crowd. But let's honor these musicians as well. And of course, as always, our sound and video team that do such a great job for us. And he has also disappeared. But the best, most outstanding, most gifted pastor of worship musician in the world, Pastor Anwar. Oh, there he is. See a man lead a group of people through such different genres of music, and he's comfortable in all. It's just an amazing thing. So we're glad you were here. Glad you were here. Now, just a few things. First of all, if you don't have any of our announcements about the meetings, raise your hand right now. You have the announcements. No hands are going up. Some from the balcony. If you want more announcements, raise your hand. I'd like to give them to you. Here we go. Here we go. Hands going up. Keep hands up high. We have a group that will be meeting at the Keystone Room. Where? Right after church. You go to the Keystone Room. That Elder Samuel, Reggie Samuel, will lead you out to the community. Take about 20 minutes. Pass them out on the blocks nearest by. Just walk by people on the street. Some may want to go down to the red line and catch them going in and coming out. Give them announcements there. What time do we start tomorrow? 7:30. 7:30. The subject is the love of God. Open up with the love of God. We're looking forward to that. Dinner is served as soon as this service is over. Our fellowship dinner. And then at 2:30, what time? We will meet in the Keystone Room. Those who can. To spend a few moments praying and seeking God's grace on that place as we do his work for the next 2.5 weeks. Let's stand. Join hands. Yeah, cross the aisle is good. Go ahead. Go ahead. Cross the aisle. Yeah. And now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit, the abiding presence of His Son and the leadership of His Word, the comforting solace of His forgiveness and grace, rest upon us and sustain us until we meet again, day tomorrow night, to begin a journey in the Word with you. Thank you for the death of Jesus on the cross, the resurrection of the same, and the promise of His soon coming. To this end we live and have hope. In Christ's name, amen. Be seated. The ushers will dismiss you. If you're going to pass out,